Hi ma'am, how are you
How are
ma'am?
you? Fine, thank you.
Ma'am, welcome ma'am. Dr. Sandhya Lakshmi, HOD of English, Soka Ikeda is here. So
Okay.
she'll be your host.
Okay.
Thank
Fine.
you so much ma'am. Your time, I mean, the floor is yours for you.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I start, Mr. Aditya?
Yes ma'am, please.
Yeah. Happy evening to all the participants. On behalf of the PG Department of English, Soka Ikeda College and Shankar IAS Academy, I extend my hearty welcome to the resource person, Ms. Jhansi Rani, IRS Deputy Commissioner of Income Tax, Chennai, and all the participants. At the outset, let me first tell you what Soka Ikeda is, because many of you have come from other colleges and you'll be wondering what it means, Soka Ikeda. Soka is a Japanese word which means value creation, creating values. The SOCA system of education prioritizes values over knowledge. They believe in building values rather than knowledge building. And the SOCA system of education was propounded in Japan by Sunesuro Magikuchi. And after him, it was taken up by Josei Toda. So after these two stalwarts, these two great people, it was taken up by Dr. Daisaku Ikeda, a Japanese poet, academician, educator, peacemaker, who has won more than 300 doctorates from different universities of the world. He took up this Soka education and he founded the Soka University in Tokyo, Japan. Our chairman, Dr. Sethu Kumanan, who is also a poet, educator, academician, and a peace lover, he has more than 6 institutions under Sethu Valliammal Trust. He was deeply inspired by one poem of Dr. Daisaku Ikeda, that is on mother. So the poem talks about the nobility of motherhood, and our chairman was deeply impressed by that, and he started a women's college in Madanakuppam in the year 2000, exclusively for women with just 70 students. Today, we have more than 18 departments functioning in shift 1 and 2, catering to more than 4,000 students. It is all because of the hard work of our chairman and the hard work of all the principals who have guided this college. So we have had a lot of historic moments in our college. We have called so many great people for our college. But today is a very, very most important, I think, one of the most important days for our college and our department particularly, because we have a very young person, a lady, that too, who has won in life, who has shown the success story, who will be a motivator and who will inspire so many people, because she has achieved such a great stature, such a great position, even at a very young age. She is none other than our resource person, Ms. Jhansi Rani, IRS. She is the Deputy Commissioner of Income Tax, Chennai. Ma'am, I am reminded of one quote when I think about you, ma'am, that a confident woman, a woman who truly knows her worth and force to be reckoned with. You are such a person, ma'am, because when I look at you, I find you quite young. At this age, you have come to such a great position. So our college is, most of the students of our college are from middle class, or rather lower middle class background. And your presence and your words will definitely enthuse them, inspire them and motivate them. We are highly thankful to you, ma'am, for joining us on this day in spite of your busy schedule. Thank you so much. I extend my most cordial welcome to you for this webinar.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you for the nice words.
Thank you, ma'am. And I welcome Mr. Ramesh Aditya from IAS Academy, who was with us, who actually helped us in organizing this webinar today. Right from the first day, we have been talking about it at so many times. Every day, he used to call me and message me. And it is like a joint venture. And I extend my cordial welcome to him. At this juncture, I'd like to thank our management, our chairman, Dr. Sethu Kumanan, secretary, Mrs. Kogilam Kumanan, our principal, Dr. M. Samshit, our advisor, Dr. P. Ranjitakani, who always motivates to go beyond our limits to call such great people and to be sure to motivate our young minds. So the floor is yours, ma'am. Girls, participants, We invite you on behalf of the college and IAS Academy. You have the most intelligent, diligent, determined, focused, and charming person here with you today to enthuse you and inspire you. Get maximum from her. Please ask her question at the end of the session. Thank you, ma'am. The floor is yours, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you for that intro. Can I start?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, warm good evening to everyone present here. Initially, I thought only participants from Soka College, but I guess it is open to people from other colleges also.
Yes, ma'am.
So, at the outset, it is a very nice initiative by the college during these difficult times to think beyond regular education needs also. You have thought well ahead of time, keeping in mind their future career options also. You are even during these times, you have thought about it and you have arranged this in association with Shankar Institute. So it is a very laudable thing that you have done. Making use of all this advancement technology, organizing this seminar to be accessible to a whole lot of people, especially women folk. It's a great initiative. I would like to congratulate you on that note first. So before we go into the so today we have gathered you on this platform basically to give you an overview about what civil service examination is all about, to have civil service as one of your career options. When you finish your colleges and come out, you should have it at the back of your mind that civil services is also one of the career options than the regular routine, medicine, engineering, teacher, whatever other options are available to you. So before I go into the topic, I'd just like to give a small intro about me. So I am Jansi Elizabeth Rani from 2012 batch of IRIS Income Tax, posted currently as Deputy Commissioner Income Tax Chennai. So before this, I was in the Indian Defence Account Services 2010 batch. I had no working experience in the Defence Department, but I was in the training. So while I was in training, I gave a subsequent attempt and I got selected in the 2012 attempt and I got into the Income Tax Department. Since then, I have served the department in various profiles. So before going actually delving into the subject or delving into what exactly civil service examination is about, the pattern of the examination, what you have to do, I'd like to give you an overview of what civil services is all about. Because you need to know why. The main question which will arise in each of your minds is when you say I have to opt for civil service a career option over the other regular options, why should I go for civil services? This is the first question which will come in a young college goer or whoever is looking for career options. The single word answer for why I should prefer civil service as a career option from my perspective is change. So change is the single word answer as to why you should prefer civil services as a career option over others. When I talk about change, don't get me wrong, when I mean change, there's an intrinsic meaning to that change. Change is not that I want to choose civil services as a career option just for a change because it sounds something different from the routine career options. Medicine, engineering, teacher, technician, musician, whatever it might be. Okay, civil services sounds something different, something very different. So I want to go in for a change. Not exactly. When I mean change, I say you should choose civil service as a career to bring about a change in your life as well as a change in the lives of people or the society at large. So this is the main reason why you should choose civil service as a career option. Change, if there is one thing which is permanent in life and in the world at large, over the years, over centuries, since time immemorial, it has only changed which has been permanent. Every change has been constant in all our spheres of life, be it the dress we wear, the food we eat, or the social events which we take part in. We are always looking for a different way to organize things, different way to consume things. Because and when we do things differently, it gives us a kind of satisfaction and sometimes pleasure depending upon the type of activity which we indulge in. So this change is a very, very important thing in life. So in order to bring about a change in your life as well as a change in the society at large, it is very important to have multiple career options. And when you say career options, civil service is not only a career, it is a life by itself. Change is the only, it is the main reason why you should choose civil services. Now, when you talk about change, rather than being very simplistic, what is this change exactly what we are talking about? Now, there is a visible and invisible part of this change which you are talking about. Now, when I say it gives you, you have to make a change in the lives of people, or you have to make it, it will contribute to a change in your own personal life, you'll be wondering how this change is going to manifest in my life or in the lives of other people. So there is an invisible and the visible part of this change which I am talking about. When you talk about the visible part, now you all must be aware that when I take up civil services, I'll become an IAS officer, IPS officer. Now the civil services examination is one single examination which is conducted to have recruitment, to make recruitment for a list of Group A and Group B services, 24 in number. So when you get recruited, so by getting just placed in this part of, you must be aware that once you, if I were to become an officer, be it whatever services I'm posted in, I will get a social prestige or an identity in the society. So this is the only thing, visible thing, which all you must be aware of. That is the only thing, prima facie, which you will have. And when I say change, I think that is the first thing which will come to your mind. But there are certain other aspects of this change, visible parts of this change, very intrinsic to the civil services when it comes to civil service as a career option. We talk about, obviously social prestige and social identity is one aspect of civil services. The second aspect which comes into is, you have an immense sense of self-satisfaction when you take up civil services as your career. But when you join a routine, when you join any other profession, which is like medicine or an engineer or whatever, maybe a teacher or an IT professional or whatever other alternate careers which we are talking about, which we are known to, whenever you get recruited, there is a standard set of procedures, there is a standard set of responsibility which is assigned to you, and the corresponding monetary package. So these are the two aspects which will come into picture when you talk about other career options. So when if you have seen the IT companies recruiting, I'm just taking IT as an example, happens most of the in other careers, it also happens like this. When you go in for a job, the two things which will be guiding your entire service in that organization will be, one is that your responsibility or your role. What is your role and what is the corresponding monetary package? So you tend to work in a particular fashion, a particular structure, more considerably over the entire length of your career, and goes on like an assembly line one after the other. And in course of time, that need for identity or self-satisfaction goes missing. Whereas in civil services, when you get recruited for civil services, you tend, depending upon the service wherever you are posted or recruited, you tend to deal with a lot of things, a diverse fields, be it administration, if you're recruited for IAS, general administration, social welfare, you tend to work with the marginalized sections of the society, and police, maintenance of law and order, if you take my case, the tax administration, you have a couple of lot of other services, the customs, trade, postal and telegraph, railways. So you have a lot of other services. So you get exposed to a lot of variety of diverse fields. And when you function as a tool of change, the kind of satisfaction which you will have when you accomplish that change is immense. And it is incomparable to any kind of monetary package which you will be delivering, either which you will be taking home, either in India or abroad in other professions. So this change which we are talking about, the important thing is the self-satisfaction, apart from the identity which you personally acquire or the social prestige you acquire in the society, the kind of self-satisfaction which you have when you become a tool of change and you're able to deliver something to people around you in your own way. It may be your family members, yourself, or your own locality, or the society at large, depending upon where you're posted and the role you are assigned, gives you a lot of self-satisfaction. And it changes the face of your future generation. Now, what is that which we are looking for? When we look for after studies, when you take up career, what is that we are looking for? One is we're looking for an identity in society. The second, we're looking for a self-esteem and self-satisfaction. All it should eventually change the face of our future generation. Now, civil services comes as an all-in-one package. When you choose civil service as a career option, all these needs get satisfied in that one package when you make the right choice. So this is, we're talking about the visible and the invisible change. Now, there are other aspects. When you talk about, it also builds your self-esteem. When you work in diverse fields, your self-esteem by being capable enough to deliver to the different needs of the society, by being as a tool of change, you also build up self-esteem in due course, and you also learn a lot. Your personality development happens in course of time. You interact with a lot of people. So, and they always say that you learn very little only from the books or on your own. You learn a lot by interactions with other people, with the society. So it is very important change which we are talking about when you choose civil services as a career option. Apart from the intrinsic aspects of change, you also have other extrinsic aspects which are very minuscule when compared to the intrinsic aspects, though I would like to list them. You have job security when you talk about civil services. You have you never retire. When you take up civil service as a career option, they say that you never retire. You work in government, and even when you retire, you are most probably wanted somewhere because of the experience which you have acquired and the acumen, professional acumen which you have. The Indian civil servants are wanted not only in India post-retirement or even during service, they are wanted in private sectors and other non-profit organizations for their valuable experience which they carry, not only in India but also abroad, because civil service functions on a different aspect in other countries when compared to India. There is no other examinations in the globe, in world over, like this civil service examination conducted by UPSC. In other countries, the civil servants are recruited, either the recruitment body goes to the colleges and they just recruit them based on a screening test, or they go and pick up specialists. Depending upon the job or the role which they want, they pick up specialists. It is only in our country, this examination has been conducted for decades together. We have people from different backgrounds taking up this examination, and all are placed on a similar platform. That is what I mean, all are placed on a similar platform. You have people from different fields, doctors, engineers, IT professionals, you have teachers, whoever who have graduated from arts, commerce, whatever background, English, literature, you have people from different backgrounds participating or giving these examinations. And the kind of rich resource which they bring into the system is very commendable. And once they come into it, the kind of background which they have, it is a good hodgepodge. When they come into the field, they come with their own backgrounds. But at the level of examination level, you're required to learn a lot of subjects which will prepare you for that bird's eye view of all the different functionalities which is required for the required once you are posted in the whatever service you are posted. So, I mean, the examination consists of, I'll talk about, once I finish this general intro, I'll talk about the pattern of the examination. I was talking about the examination pattern in other countries. So this examination pattern is very unique to India. You don't have such a system in other countries where people from different backgrounds opt for such a common examinations, come into the system with rich background and with rich resource and contribute to this result called change. So that is why Indian bureaucrats are wanted not only in India, both during service, post-retirement, but also abroad. So change is the one thing which is very, very, it is a basic reason, or it is a one more, it is a very great reason to choose civil service as a career option. So I have spoken about the visible and the invisible aspects of change, primarily being your ability to make a change in the lives of other people as well as in your own life. Eventually, when you become part of the service, you will develop yourself as well as you will contribute to the development of the society. Now, moving on, we'll talk about more when we take up your questions. We'll talk about the specialty of civil service, a career option. Before that, let me give a bird's eye view of what civil services is all about. Now, this civil service examination is being conducted by the Union Public Service Commission, which is headquartered in Delhi. When you talk about the pattern of the examination, there are three levels of examination. That is, you call the preliminary level, the mains, and the interview, which is called the personality test. It is not a normal interview in the common parlance, which you call as an interview in other professions. It is called as a personality test. So at the preliminary level, you have two papers. You have paper one and paper two. Paper one is about general studies. It is termed as general studies, where you have a list of subjects. And paper two is about aptitude test. So first paper, when I talk about a list of subjects, it is for each paper is for one. The paper one will be of 100 questions. The second paper will be of 80 questions. Both will be of 200 marks, 2 hours duration. Now the question, the topics or the subjects which you have to cover for the first paper will be the general subjects which we have all studied in our schools. Geography, history, polity, environmental science and technology, and current affairs of national and international importance. So these are all general subjects, which the syllabus will be, the UPSC syllabus will give you an outline of what you have to cover for the preliminary part of it, and the curriculum and the textbooks is available open in the market, and it is not a great deal. And once you clear the preliminary examination, now you have to clear the preliminary examination to qualify for the mains examination, and it is only kind of a screening test. Once you clear the preliminary examination, the marks which you secure in the preliminary examination will not be counted for ranking purpose in the final stage. Once you clear the preliminary examination, you will be admitted to the mains level. Now, while the preliminary examination is a objective type, that is, choose the right answer types, you will be given 4 options. You have to choose the right one among the options given. There is a negative marking also. It is 1/3 negative marking is there. So when you successfully pass the preliminary examination, you will progress into the main stage. Now at the mains level, you have 9 papers, of which 2 are qualificatory in nature. When I mean qualificatory, that is, you have to just secure qualifying marks. One is the English paper and the other is the any Indian language. These are qualifying in nature. Only once you qualify in these 2 papers, the other papers will be taken for evaluation purpose. So what about the other 7 papers? The syllabus is almost the same as what you have studied in your preliminary, except for the optional subjects. Now, in your preliminary, you will be learning only the subjects which I told, the general papers. Now, in your mains, you have to choose one optional paper. There is a list of optional subjects available. From that list, you can choose whichever optional you are comfortable with. You can have a look at the optional papers, the course syllabus, the question papers, previous year's question papers, and you can choose whichever is suiting your personality and which is suiting your aptitude, which you are comfortable with. The language, you have languages also, Indian languages also as an optional paper. You have literature options. I mean, Tamil literature or Hindi literature, you have optional papers like that also. So you can choose one among them, and you have 2 papers in your optional papers, paper 1 and paper 2. And apart from that, you will have 4 general studies papers and 1 essay paper. Now, after qualifying in your mains examination, you go to the next level called the personality test, or referred to as interview level in the common parlance. Now, in the interview level, interview is for a qualifying mark of around 275 marks. So it will appear at the interview level. Interview is not similar to interview which happens in other disciplines. It is more of an assessment of your personality, who you have been, how they will assess you on how as a person you are capable enough of dealing with the varied challenges that you may have to face in the once posted in the government. So it will be an assessment of your personality. It will be in discussion, mostly a discussion about it. It may vary from factual, basic factuals about your background to general issues which are of national, international importance and associated events. So it is generally a discussion. So it is an assessment of your personality, whom as a person you have grown over these 22, 23 plus years whenever you appear at your interview stage. So these are the three levels. Once you clear your personality test, you will be ranked based on the cumulative marks which you have secured in your mains examination and interview level. You will be ranked based on the total number of marks which you have secured. And this examination is conducted for recruitment to Group A and Group B services put together. There are around 24 services in the list. Based on the rank which you secure, you will be allotted the service based on the rank and as well as the number of vacancies available in each of these services, you will be allotted either one of the service. So you have the IAS, IPS, the Indian Administrative Service, Indian Police Service, Indian Foreign Service. Then you have the Indian Revenue Service, Income Tax, Customs, Postal and Telecom, Railway Service, Railway Traffic Service, Indian Defense Account Service, Estate Service, Pondicherry Civil Service, Pondicherry Police Service, which are come under the category of Group B. So like this, you have category of 24 services which you are recruited. So once you get recruited, based upon the service which you're recruited in, you will be allotted posts and you will be allotted the service and you have to undergo fixed months of training. There's a foundation course which happens, 3 months of foundation course depending upon the service which you're allocated. It will happen at different locations and then you go to parent academies of the service which you are selected to have a training, post which you will be posted in your respective profiles. So this is a bird's eye overview of the examination pattern. When I say civil services, first question which you would have, I have answered the first question which would have come up in your mind, that why I should choose civil services as a career option when preferred to other disciplines. So I told you that the single word answer is change. Now, apart from that, you will have a lot of questions as to what is the eligibility criteria to appear in this examination. There is no fixed eligibility. The only eligibility criteria is that you have to be a graduate and you have to be an Indian citizen. This is the only criteria. If you see that civil service is one of the best examples of democracy available in our country. If you see what is the best example of a democracy, you can just blindly say it is civil services examination, because it gives equal opportunity to everybody, irrespective of the background which you come from. You might come from, I'm talking about the background, not only about the educational background, about your financial background, whether you are from a poor family, you are from a rich family, you are from a middle class family, you're an affluent in English, you're not affluent in English, or you are from a commerce background, arts background, science background, or you are from an IIT, IIM, civil services treats everybody on an equal footing. It is immaterial as to whether you are a school topper or a college topper or you're a gold medalist or a silver medalist. Civil services says that I treat everyone equally. For me, what matters is that what have you done for this examination in that particular attempt? And most unique part of civil services is that each attempt is a separate attempt. It is not like why civil services still today, even being conducted for civil for decades, still stands out separately, is that it is not like any other examinations. Like once you have prepared, the next time I can sit back and relax. I can just prepare for before 1 month or 15 days and can go give this exam. No, it requires a dedicated preparation for each and every attempt. That is why still we are conducting sessions like this, which we are having today, for decades, for years together. When I started preparation way back in 2003 till today, 2020, so many years I'm seeing that, you know, still people, it remains, it is not one which can be easily gone, and it is not one examination where you give the books and you ask them to prepare and you sit down and you just clear it off like that. Now, the most important qualities which you require for clearing this examination is not knowledge. Let me put it very clear. It is not one of those examination which rests its success on knowledge. Of course, knowledge gathering is essential, but it not only depends upon knowledge gathering. The two most important aspects for any civil service aspirant is discipline and perseverance. So if you have these two aspects during your preparation, definitely you are to succeed in your attempt, whether it be even in their first attempt. With a little bit of discipline and perseverance, knowledge gathering will happen in due course. Anybody who's serious about this will come in, will spend their time and will gather the knowledge. But what is important is that you should have some amount of discipline and perseverance to succeed in this examination. So it is one of the greatest tools of democracy available to us. Make use of it, utilize it, and opt for it. Today, the country needs young talent with novel ideas to give solutions to the challenges of the changing times. So I appeal to each one of you to keep or to take your attention off from the routine and just think of civil service as a career option. It is not only a career, it is a life by its own. When you become part of the services, you will realize that you are living a life of your own and you are making immense change and impact, not only in your lives, in lives of others, in your inner circle, outer circle, and the society at large. So I would like to stop here, and I would like to request the participants to participate, because it would be more useful if I could respond to their queries. And I would give my concluding remarks, putting together your queries in the end. So I would like to keep the floor open for questions now, if any, and I will give my concluding remarks based on the queries which the students have.
Thank you, ma'am. Participants can raise their question. I think there are three questions in the Q&A box, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. So,
ma'am, can you see the box?
Yeah, I can see. So I would like to start from the general questions. What is the perfect age to write civil service examination? Once you're 21 years, you're eligible to write civil service examination. Now, if you take me, I started my preparation when I finished my undergraduation. So I was just 20. So I was not eligible to appear. So I spent 1 year till I was 21 to prepare. So there's no age limit when I should start. Now, when I went for a session in Coimbatore, I think also organized by Shankar, last year, there was a candidate who started a preparation when she was in 12th standard. So I was really surprised to see that they're starting off at a very early age. Now with the technology advancement and more of, reach of information, I think people are getting aware and starting off early. So there's no one particular age as soon as you're 21, depending upon, and it is, as far as civil service concerned, my advice would be start early, both for your benefit and for the benefit of the government we set up. So it is good for you that you start early, because you have other distractions. Once you age, you will have other distractions. So you start early. Once you finish your undergraduation, when you're fag end of your undergraduation, I think it is the right time that you should start. Now, there's one more general question, like how you should learn about society. There is no one criteria or one way which I can tell you how to learn about society. You learn about society in due course. So you have to, you would have learned about society in your, 17, 18 years of your lifetime. You would have learned a lot many things in your own way, though not in a very large way. But then when you become part of civil services or whatever, in your whatever, wherever you are placed, whatever capacity you're working, you learn about society when you interact with them, and when you contribute and when you take part in their problems, or when you become part of the problem solving setup, you will learn about society in the due course. So there is no one methodology where you can learn about the society from textbooks. how many years have I prepared for the exam? Now, I told you, I came to the field as soon as I finished my undergraduation. So that was 2006, I came into the field, and I cleared in my 2010 batch, as in 2010 attempt, second attempt. I cleared my first time, I cleared in my first attempt. I gave my first attempt in 2009. I didn't clear my preliminary. I cleared all the three levels of examination in my 2010 attempt, and I got selected in Indian Defence Account Services. And 2013 attempt, I got, I appeared, I didn't get through. And 2014 attempt, I again got selected in civil services, and thereafter I have not given any attempt. So you can see I started off in 2006, so you may say 4-5 years I have spent in preparing for the exam. But each one takes different time. It's not, mine is not a criteria for you. Each one takes their own time. Some may clear it in their first attempt, second attempt. Depends upon the dedication and the quality of time spent in preparing for the exam. Now, what will we learn in training? Now, post recruitment in civil service examination. Now, depending upon, there will be 3 months of foundation course where it will be general training, as in general administration. Then you will have a lot of extracurricular activities. You will have people from all services being put together. Mostly it will be kind of an inter-service coordination. Post those foundation course training, you will have dedicated training of fixed number of months, depending upon each service has their own number of months of training, starting from 12 months to 1.5 years to 2 years, depending upon the service where you are posted. You learn about the subjects which you are going to deal with. Now, if you take me, I can only talk for myself. If you take me, so we were in our training academies, we were taught about taxation. So this, because that is the one we are going to implement in our career. So we had to learn about taxation. So, and if you take about police, they'll be learning about law and order. So it is like that for each, and depending upon the service which you are selected in, apart from the 3 months general course, it will be the service-based or service-oriented training. Is it compulsory to take coaching in any institute? It is not compulsory, but then it is always nice when you give up your first attempt, you're new to the field, and it will be difficult for you to keep track of things which is happening around you. And it is always good that you congregate in either small groups to have a connect. Otherwise, because it's not an examination, it is not a 3 months examination or a 4 months course, or you just prepare for 1 month, you read something and you go and give. It is a 1 year long examination. Your examination, your preliminary examination starts in May, and you give your mains in December. You take up your interview or personality test in the subsequent March to April. So it's like a 1 year long examination. So in order to keep you first, when you are a first timer, it is always better for the first attempt to go and join an institute to have a basic understanding of what the system is, of what the examination is about, what is the requirement of the system. And to align yourself with the requirements of the system, it is always necessary that you join an institute. But you can. There are a lot of people who have prepared without joining an institute also. But in these times when there are a lot of distractions, and in order to keep yourself, it is always good to associate with other people and to know where you're lacking from. It is a give and take policy. You learn a lot from others rather than self-study. So to keep you both mentally active and to take away that fatigue, or to keep you always on the track, it is always good. So the first attempt, you join an institute and you prepare. Subsequent attempts, it depends upon your personal choice whether you join an institute or not. Depends upon you, because some people prefer studying on their own. Some people find it good when they have a helping hand. So subsequent attempts, yes, it is up to you, depending upon your personal demands and choice. But in the first attempt, it is advisable to join an institute and study. How many will it take to complete this course? I guess how long it will to complete this course? I told you, it will require 1 year of dedicated preparation to before you give your first attempt, because it will take to accommodate yourself with what the field is about, because all our education system prior to both our school, colleges would have functioned in a very different way. But here, when you come to civil services, you will try to you will have to unlearn things which you have learned. You will require to unlearn things which you, the same things which you might have learned when you come into the field and read. You will see that it is all very familiar to you, but you will learn it in a different way. For civil service examination, there will be a why, how, analytical base for each and everything which you have already learned. So you will learn things which are known to you in a new fashion. That's all. But then you will at least need that 6 to 7, I would require 1 year of preparation before, I would advise 1 year of serious preparation before you give your first attempt. So thereafter, it depends upon your level of preparation in your first attempt. Thereafter, suppose if you don't make it in your first attempt, the second attempt, it depends upon the activities which you are engaging, whether you're working or you're solely dedicating, depends upon the time which you put in. Whereas, and one more thing, when you give your, I told you there are 3 levels, preliminary, mains and interview level. If you don't, suppose you clear your preliminary and you go to your mains level, if you clunk in your mains, you have to again come and give your preliminary, and then only you have to go through all these 3 stages. So 1 year of dedicated preparation is good. Yes, and one thing I wanted to, I thought I'll keep it to the end for the closing remarks. Good that somebody has asked this question. Give some good ideas to read newspaper. It's difficult to create the habits, taking long time to read. Now, reading newspaper is one habit which all of us have to cultivate. Reading newspaper from times when I used to prepare till today, Hindu as is being the single subscription for civil service preparation. So I would advise you to read Hindu newspaper. Now skip all the political news. What is required for civil service examination is core national and international news, which is of relevance for the examination, and not political news. Concentrate on events which are happening around you. And obviously, for a first-time reader who doesn't have any reading habit, reading Hindu newspaper, or for that matter, any English newspaper, will be difficult. It will take its time. But when you start to read a Hindu newspaper, it will take anywhere between 2.5 to 3 hours. When you sit down and read an English newspaper for serious preparation, it will take for 2.5 to 3 hours. But don't worry, as you progress, it will all. The time which you put in reading a newspaper will come down as you keep on reading. So it will happen unconsciously. Not necessary that it has to. It will not happen consciously. So don't expect that you read once a week, because when you are a first-time reader, you have to get accommodated to the language used. You have to get used to the habit of assimilating the news and understanding it. Vocabulary, all that is there. So as you put in 1 to 2 months, give yourself sufficient time. Don't be very harsh with reading a newspaper. Even if you take time, since all you're in your college now, at different years, maybe even in your final year, start the habit of reading newspapers. Be aware of what is happening around you, even if not for civil services. Be an informed citizen. So start reading newspapers, and it will take 2.5 to 3 hours. Some it may take more than 3 hours also. Don't worry. Don't be so harsh on yourself. So get accustomed to the reading habit first. So as time progresses, maybe after 2 months, 3 months, it will come down to 1.5 hours. So you start reading Hindu newspaper. So how many attempts can we make depending upon the category? There are different categories of, as in your caste background. When you're an OBC category, you have 9 attempts, and then you have a general category, 6 attempts, and then you have your scheduled caste category. So depending upon the category which you belong, you will have the number of attempts you can take. There is the restriction, the number of attempts you can take. Now, Indian Forest Service, there is one query about Indian Forest Service and Indian Foreign Service. So Indian Forest Service, there is a separate examination for that. Indian Foreign Service comes as part of Indian Civil Service Examination, as I told you. It is one of the services in the entire list of the 24 services. So there is no separate preparation for that. The same will apply to Indian Forest Service. So Forest Service, they have the same preliminary examination being conducted by UPSC, and the mains examination onwards, they have a separate examination. Same three levels appear for them, the preliminary, mains, and the interview level, personality test, which is a best optional subject. It depends upon, now when you have to select your options, it depends upon your it depends upon the interest, your own interest. It depends upon the interest which you have. Suppose if you're a commerce student, or if you're an arts student for that matter, arts may interest you now. And if you will have an interest to take your own background. You may have a graduation in commerce, you may have graduation in history, you may be a science graduate. Can I take the same options for civil services? You can take, but just have a look at the syllabus and the question papers, because many times what happens is that you may have, it is the studying a subject for 3 years as part of your collegiate education and studying the same for civil services as an optional subject are two different things. It's a different ball game. So you have to go through the syllabus and question paper and see if you are comfortable with the syllabus and the question paper, and then decide. Just because you have done a graduation in that particular background, don't blindly choose that option because you are very familiar with that subject. Now, if you take, for example, I did an undergraduate in history, but then when I attempted, I didn't give an attempt, but then when I looked at the syllabus in history and my and the question papers, I was not very comfortable or confident enough to give the options in that subject. So I went on to take public administration as one of my optional. And I progressed because of studying public administration, one of the optional in civil service examination. I went on to do my post-graduation as well as my MPhil in public administration. So studying an optional subject for the purpose of civil service examination is different from what you do in your college as a particular subject. So you have to, I cannot give you one over-the-counter prescription as to this is the best option. What might be suitable for me might not be suitable for you. So you have to go through the list of optional subjects, have a look at the syllabus and the question papers, and take an informed decision after consulting seniors, or when you join an institute, have reviews from 2-3 people, or more than, you know, at least, because see, once you put and invest your time and effort in a subject, then going back is not advisable, though people have done it, and I myself have done it, changed options, but then it is not advisable. When you put in, say, at least when you prepare for your mains, you would have prepared at least 4-5 months for that particular optional subject. So it is better that before you choose and invest your time in it, you discuss with your people in services, seniors who have prepared, as well as your institute wherever you're joining, before choosing an option. Now, how to study for an exam? I already told you. So you have to be, when you're a first timer, you just join, you can join on, you can study on, you know, just join, or you join in institute. First timers, it is advisable to join an institute and start your preparation. So I told you the syllabus. So just the curriculum, basically you start off with the NCERT books. That is a basic textbook you just start off for the examination. So you follow the textbooks as well as the newspaper. So newspaper is the part of the entire civil service examination. So that is the most important part of it. Rest, the you follow the syllabus and the textbooks which are being prescribed for the examination. So what is the topic that we should get started? There's no specific topic. I don't get what is the exact question. So how many years or months it will take to complete this course? I've already told you that there is no specific time limit. Advisable before taking the first attempt, you put in at least 1 year of serious preparation. Thereafter, it depends upon your level of preparation. You may either clear it in the first attempt or progress on to the subsequent attempts. So what are the general things we should concentrate for studying exams? So there are no, as far as civil service is concerned, general things, you start off with the newspaper. So general thing, if you ask me, you start off with the newspaper. Newspaper is the, it is general as well as specific in its own way. So you, once you cultivate the habit of reading a newspaper and you are very comfortable with, I think 30 to 40% of civil service examination is done with. Minimum preparation time for civil service, I've already answered that. What is your role presently? Income tax. I'm currently posted as Deputy Commissioner Income Tax, and I'm taking care of assessment of corporate companies right now. Can we clear the exam in the first time? Take several attempts. How to prepare? Which is the correct way? You can clear it. As I told you again and again, it is. It depends upon the sincerity or the dedication which you put in your first attempt. There is nothing that you cannot clear this examination the first attempt. It is all in your hands. So you just, the two things which I told you, dedication and perseverance and knowledge gathering. You have to have a bird's eye view of all the topics or all the subjects which I have told you, like history, geography, polity, science and technology, environment, current affairs, and you will be through. I think you shouldn't have any hitches in that, on that count. So how will interview happen? Is it is conducted by, there are different panels which is being formed by UPSC. So it's called a board. So there'll be a panel of members from different fields. So one will be a board member, the chairperson, the other will be members. So you will have people from diverse fields asking you questions from your background. You will have situation questions, as in they will give you a particular situation and ask you to give you solutions. There might be questions from your educational background, from your first, from your extracurricular activities, whatever you are given in your DAF form. So questions can come from anywhere in that DAF form, or it may have one or two situation-based questions also. So it happens in Delhi, and it is a panel of members appointed by the board. So which will be easy to clear, UPSC or TNPSC? Now, it again depends. There is no one. I cannot tell you that this is easy or that is easy, but given the syllabus and the curriculum of the syllabus and the requisites of the examination, I think in my perspective, UPSC is more easy, or the time and the effort which you put in, if you go organized and if you are very systematic, UPSC is not. I understand your question is whether TNPSC is easy or UPSC is easy. UPSC is not that, not, it's not that a hard nut to crack when compared to TNPSC, because again, the syllabus and the knowledge gathering which happens is very minimal. It is purely based on smart work and the certain techniques which you acquire during the course of preparation. Now, this is one exam where you'll be, where even during the preparation phase itself, you'll become a more mature person. You'll acquire more techniques. You will have to acquire more techniques in clearing this examination rather than pure knowledge gathering. So it is up to you. Now, while you prepare, there are candidates who have at the same time when they prepare UPSC, they give all competitive examinations. So, and once you prepare for UPSC, you can give the other examinations even without much preparation, except for touching on, if you take Tamil Nadu Public Service Commission, you can touch upon Tamil Nadu specific aspects only apart from the regular UPSC preparation you have made. So once you have prepared UPSC, you can give a hell lot of other competitive examinations. It is like the superior package. Once you master that, you can give, once you prepare for UPSC, you can give any other competitive examination. Comes like a bonus package for you. So I would advise you to prepare for UPSC. Always aim for the higher. If I start my preparation from, is it possible to crack exam in 2 years? What UG course you have completed? Yes, it is possible. I do not know which year of your college you are in, whether you are in a final year, or most probably assume that you're in a final year. So I told you that only eligibility is you have to be 21 years of age, and 1 year of dedicated preparation is all the more sufficient to crack this examination. And I have done my undergraduation in history and my post-graduation in public administration. How to prepare for this examination? Can we do it at home or institute? Please advise. I told you already, I have answered this question. You can prepare for your home, but for first timers who do not know about the field, and to keep you motivated and stay on track and to have interaction with other civil service aspirants, better for your first attempt to join an institute and prepare. It is very different to clear UPSC. It's not very different. Different in the sense, it is, you do not know rote learning here. You just have to understand. You'll be very surprised when you take up this examination and you sit down for preparing. You'll be very surprised to know that you are learning the basics. What you have, you know what you are learning, but you are learning it in a different way. So that's the key point in UPSC. So you will learn things in the way it has to be learned, and with knowing the actual meaning, questioning each and everything, understanding it, analyzing each and every concept. So that is the difference between other examinations and the UPSC examination, or what you have learned earlier, you will unlearn and relearn the same thing in a different fashion. So there comes the difference in UPSC. So you said optional paper also has language and literature paper. Can take same language papers and qualifying paper and optional paper. Yes, you can do that. What is the best civil service job? So there's no one best and there's no one least service. Every job is best in their own way. So as long as you contribute and derive self-satisfaction, you will enjoy wherever you are posted. You're going to be a tool of change wherever you are posted. So there's no one best job. Each one has its own perks, advantages and disadvantages. So you will have to balance each and everything. So there's no one best civil service job in those entire category of services. So a lot of questions about interview. I'll just keep it to the end. Interview experience. Regulation only after signing the current cadence was eligible to appear once again in civil service examination. See, for other central services, you have to, you can give your examination while you are in services. Whereas for all other services, you have to resign and only then reappear in the subsequent attempts. How to study current affairs in newspaper? I've already told you that current affairs, leave alone, let alone the political aspects, and concentrate on pure events of national and international importance. So they say newspaper reading is a must. So in what ways you've studied, how can we bring interest in reading? Because I find it difficult. So there is, don't be very harsh on yourself as far as newspaper is concerned. Just take it, read it like a story. Just don't have a mindset that we are just going to learn something. You're just going to know about things which are happening around you. So you just read it like how you read, how you're going to read a normal other entertainment magazines which you'll be reading. The same inclination, you first approach a Hindu newspaper. And don't worry about the time which you invest in it. As time passes, you will, the time which you invest or spend will gradually come down. So don't go in it, go inside it with a negative mindset that I'm taking such a lot of time and it's not very interesting. So you're not learning something. You're just keeping yourself informed about things which is happening around you. So just approach it that way, and definitely it will become an interesting venture. So is there any specific books? I told you for civil service examination, there are no specific books. You start off the basic books for civil service preparation is NCRT. Then options, they will prescribe you. There are a lot of books available in the market. And as far as civil service examination concerned, there's nothing about books. Apart from the basic knowledge which you acquire, it is about how you show your individuality in presentation of answers. Now, while the preliminary is objective type, mains is a descriptive type. So it depends on how you show your individuality in your mains examinations. So you're very creative in how you present your papers, apart from the understanding which you have secured by investing in the preparation process.
Excuse me, ma'am. Take a breath, please.
Can we read the questions to you, ma'am?
Madam will do it.
Yeah.
Can I read the questions to you,
yeah,
ma'am?
Yeah.
Because many questions are repetitive, ma'am, and your ma'am, there is a question whether I can go to a job and I can pursue the course. Will it be difficult for me if I do both, or should I spend the whole time for this preparation? There's a question, ma'am.
See, whether I should, like, I can take up a job and parallelly do a preparation is up to you totally. If you have that an ambition, if you have that fire burning with you, nothing is going to stop you. Let me tell you that. There are a lot of people who have who are married with children, going to job, not a good financial background. They have done it all together. So there is no one thing which is going to stop you. The ultimate decision maker and ultimate resolution is in your hands. So there is nothing which is going to stop you. And see, as far as civil services preparation is concerned, initial stage, if you put in a solid 4 to 5 hours of solid preparation, apart from newspaper reading, it is good. It will do. But then 1 year of serious preparation is a must. It should not be that I'll go for on and off preparations. I will go for my job. So you should, it all depends upon you to keep both, to have a balanced view, both with respect to your job as well as pure preparation. So you should not lose sight of it. That's the only consideration. There's nothing that you cannot do. So you.
There's one question. Who inspired you to take this UPSC exam? What was the source of inspiration for you?
I don't know whether it is a good thing or bad thing. There's never been a source of inspiration for me. And I don't know. Suddenly, I've in the sense that I have never looked at somebody and aspired for this service. Just came to me. Still, I've yet to find an answer for that. So I don't have any source of inspiration. I want to be part of the civil services. I don't know what created an interest in me to offer civil services. So I have no family background also in civil service. My mother was a school teacher. So I have no inspiration as such. I had never, I didn't have any inspiration as such for joining civil services.
And one question is, how far the PG is useful to take up this UPSC exam post-graduation?
Oh. See, undergraduation, post-graduation is all just eligibility criteria to appear in this examination. So any amount of, even as I told you already, even if you have done your education IIT or IIM, the experience which you gather there will some way be helpful to you in one or the other aspects during the preparation. But whether I should do my PG and will I be more capable enough to handle this examination if I do a PG? No, not necessarily. It is not necessary that you should do a PG and you'll be more emboldened enough to give this examination, more confident enough. What is required is that your 1 year, what is that preparation which you are putting in the civil services? That is the only thing which matters as far as clearing this examination is concerned.
One question is whether she will be posted in the own state or somewhere else in India once she clears the exam.
Okay. So that depends upon the policies of the department or wherever you are posted. Suppose you are selected for IAS. IAS, there are three services which are apart from Indian Forest Service, two services which are called as All India Services, Indian Administrative Service and Indian Police Service. Now, once you get selected in the service, based on your ranking and based on your ranking, you will be allotted the states. They are called cadres. So your preference might be, say, you are from Tamil Nadu. Your preference might be, first preference, I want to come to my home state, Tamil Nadu. So you should have secured that ranking to be able to be give your first choice. So this is the criteria for All India Services. When you come to Central Services, like for me, now we are called as Central Services, but then we are like, now once the IAS and IPS, once they are allotted to a particular state or a particular cadre, they will serve the entire career in that state only. So they will be posted in different districts in that state. Whereas to take Central Services, depends upon initial posting, might happen in your state, in your own home state or not. But subsequently, you will get transferred to different states depending upon there is a time limit for you to serve in a particular state. And you will not be positioned in your home state for the entire career if you happen to be selected in one of the central services. You will have to be rotating all over India. Actually, it is the truly All India Services is the central services because they'll be roaming all around India. So you cannot serve the entire career in your home state.
What are the common obstacles one faces in the preparation, ma'am?
Preparation
kind of obstacles.
Yes. What I hear from aspirants and what I have experienced is that because of the length of the preparation, like you have to put in minimum 1 year. If you're going to clear it in your first term, you have to put in 1 year of concentrated preparation. So in that 1 year, it is very difficult for one because we are human beings, there are a lot of distractions and then fatigue which creeps in. and you are new to the field and you have to assimilate into, though it is a bird's eye view, you have to assimilate a lot of subjects at one go. So it's basically the fatigue which keeps in and the lot of diversions. That is the basic thing. Apart from the societal interference, I think you'll be able to handle it either at your personal level or at your family level. It all depends upon the cumulative support which one family as a whole extends to you. So that I think which we can handle, but at the personal level, preparation wise, if you see the fatigue thing which creeps in. Now that is why I say first attempt you have to join an institute, so you form your own small group so that to keep you motivated. So at one or the other time, there is one person to pull you up. Yes. So because, you know, there is this human tendency, once you are down, when you see other person standing, you wake up and yes, I will also have to. When that internal fire goes down, there's something external to lit you up again. So for that, that is the only thing. I think in the everybody, every civil service aspirant faces this. I think in due course, each one will lend a helping hand to the other. Otherwise, there are these faculty members. When you join an institute, there are faculty members who bring you on track, right? So that is the only basic, biggest difficulties. And obviously, I think as a team, you will be able to overcome it in due course.
Ma'am, you have already told that you have to start with NCERT books, and they are asking for some websites where they can get the syllabus and other materials, ma'am.
No, you just, now it is all open source. So you just Google, you just type civil service syllabus and civil service materials. You just get hold of this NCERT books, and the materials and newspaper and everything is open source. There's no one particular website. There are a lot of websites which is available open source. So there's no one particular website which I can subscribe. You just type civil service syllabus and civil service materials. There are a hell lot of materials on the net.
I am one question is that I am a medical student. What type of optional subject is best for me?
So again, medical, there is, whereas whether you are very comfortable in giving medicine as an optional subject in your mains examination, only you have to take a decision whether I am comfortable. So I told you my example. I was an undergraduate in history, but I was not very comfortable enough to give history as one of my options. Same way, you have to evaluate yourself, because there are, I have seen people who are doctors and who have taken medicine who have succeeded in their examination, but there I have seen doctors who are not comfortable with medicine as an option for civil services, and they have gone for art subjects and they have succeeded. So it all depends upon you. You have to have a, again I tell you, you have to look at your syllabus, the question papers, and see whether you are comfortable in dealing with the option for civil service examination. You have to decide. So I cannot prescribe you, but I would, if given an option, I would advise you to go in for something a little lighter option than medicine.
Ma'am, can you answer, ma'am? Can we go? Some more questions, ma'am?
I think I'll have 5 minutes more.
We take yes. Okay. They're asking about the personality test. Your experience in personality test.
I wanted to answer that. See, personality test was, I attended two interviews, because 2010 attempt when I was selected in Defense Account Service, that was my first interview. So I was 22 years then. And when I gave my second attempt, second interview, I was in the 2012. So it was like 2 years gap. So I was 24 then. So in my first attempt, 22, first interview was not very satisfactory even to myself. So in the sense that I think I was not, I was not more mature enough to handle it. It's very nervous, very anxious in that first attempt, like everyone. And don't be very desperate when you go. My only advice when you take up an interview or personality test, don't be very desperate and don't show to the board that you're very desperate for that. Things never come to you when you're desperate. And this is holds true for everything in life. And interview, this personality test is not an exemption for that. So don't be very desperate that, don't show to the board. Even if you're desperate, even if you're anxious, don't show to the board that you are very desperate. And that doesn't come as a one-off solution. Like you go to the door of the interview board and you say, I'm not anxious, I'm not desperate. No, you have to cultivate it during your preparation time itself and say that, if not for it, I'm not telling it the other way. You always have to be mentally stable in order to receive what the board wants from you and give the best out of you. You have to be a very balanced person you have to be very calm and mature to handle the interview board. So that I was lacking, to be very frank and to accept. I think in my first interview, I was very desperate enough to finish it off and get a service. So I was very desperate, so I was not able to handle simple questions which were known to me, which I would have better answered if I was in a very calm state of mind. So that was the takeaway from my first interview. When I attended my subsequent interview, I was already in Defense Account Service, already in a service. So I was not very desperate. I'm just stressing on the word desperate because I'm talking out of my own experience. So when for my second interview, I already had a job. So that gave me a lot of confidence and it was not desperate enough. So even if I get it and if I not get it, I was okay with it. So that was my best interview. And I handled, there were a lot of situation-based questions and I handled it at least to my satisfaction and got me good score also in that attempt. But the amount of preparation which I put in for an interview at my second interview was very less, in the sense that so for an interview, that is why it is called as a personality test. It is an assessment of your personality rather than the knowledge you have acquired. So the kind of preparation which I put in, when you compare my second interview, my first interview and second interview is very less, my second interview. But the kind of confidence and the calmness and the balance mode which I had was very good. So as far as the interview is concerned, you have to remain calm and trust in yourself and go with a balanced mind. That is very essential in an interview.
The questions are more or less the same. They are asking for the books or the optional subjects. More or less the same. I think you have answered everything, ma'am. Let me just age limit. Almost the same type of questions, ma'am.
Okay.
So you'd like to say something more?
Yeah, I just would conclude by saying that have civil services as a career option on priority on your table when you look or when you think of your career options, what you're going to do after your college. They say that once you clear civil service, you become part of the creamy layer of the society. You become the cream of the society. And you become the cream of society, not only for you, you become the topping or the icing on the society itself. By creating a change, not for yourself as well as for the society, to make change for your future generation, your inner circle, outer circle, the civil service preparation. So when you come into the field, don't come with an attitude of how many years I'm going to put in, how many attempts I'm going to take, doesn't matter. Unless you attend, you reach that goal, any number of years of preparation which you put in this field is worth. Take it from me. I've spent 4 years of preparation in this field. So I'm not a one-timer who have cleared this in the first attempt. So any number of years of service which you put in this is going to make you a more balanced, more matured person to deal with the challenges of your everyday life, as well as to respond to the challenges which you'll be facing as a government servant. So it will make you a very balanced person, matured person in society, and it will give you an identity and social, build up your self-esteem and give you a social identity and prestige in society. So for your own personal cause and greater cause of the society, I would like to invite all of you young talent to come with an open mind and take up civil services as a career option. Wish you all the best and hoping to see you all part of different services.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Yeah. I think it is more than 1 hour. You're talking for more than 1 hour, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am? Yeah. You have completely all the nuances of the civil service exam and how to have a first in the beginning itself, how to have a change in the mindset and the exam pattern, the necessary qualities required to take up a civil service exam, like discipline and perseverance, the books, everything. You have given us a very good picture of everything, ma'am. Thank you so much. On behalf of the SOCA fraternity, from the management, principal, staff and students, I extend my thanks to you, ma'am, for sparing your time and giving us a very, very good presentation. I think our girls are very much motivated.
Thank you.
People taking up civil service from our college, ma'am.
Thank you. Happy.
Thank you, ma'am. And I extend my thanks to Mr. Ramesh Aditya, who was behind all this, organizing all this webinar. Thank you so much, Ramesh sir. And I thank my management, my principal, and even all the participants for making it a great show. Thank you all.
Thank you. Wish you all the good luck.
Thanks, ma'am. Thanks, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and be here today. And it has been a breathtaking 1 hour and 20 minute session. And you answered all the questions. Actually, to be honest with you, you answered 60 plus questions today.
Okay.
In observing the session, being a silent observer today, and I found that 63 questions you have answered. Okay. And so when it is something very great, that is why, you know, we respect you a lot. And it has been a long session in Coimbatore when we traveled down to Coimbatore with Krishnamal College again. So that shows your commitment towards young children, that to women children. Thank you so much for your support, ma'am. Shankar IAS Academy is always indebted to you.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, Dr. Sandhya Lakshmi, ma'am, for this wonderful opportunity. And
thank you, sir.
One beautiful thing is that the students who attended this session, they didn't go out of the session till you completed your questions and answers, ma'am. So that's what I wanted to inform you, that I believe that there will be more women children will come into services, and taking you as a role model, Jhansi Rani, ma'am. And I think there is one child has typed saying that, ma'am, I'm also Jhansi Rani.
Yeah, I saw that.
So you've been a role model, and you'll continue to be a role model. Thank you so much, ma'am. Wish you a great evening all together. Wish you a great evening to all of you online right now. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Participants, I have posted the feedback form, and you can fill it and send it to us, and the participation certificates will be mailed to you.